I'm so glad you made it. Did you just get here? Can I sing all the songs I have sang over again? Brandy, you know I love you. But you know I just can't do that. My Cinderella. Miss Brandy, y'all, let's give it up. Let's give it up. She made it.
Whitney Houston is about to make a dream come true, her own. She is bringing a brand new Cinderella to TV. She executive produces and stars as the fairy godmother. Whitney is joined by Brandy as Cinderella and Whoopi Goldberg as the queen. Jason Alexander is Prince Charming's valet and Bernadette Peters is the wicked stepmom. As Whitney shows us in this ET exclusive, it's a far cry from Julie Andrews' Cinderella of 40 years ago.
I'm your fairy godmother, honey.
She's my fairy godmother. I'm so excited.
Now, with a full cast, Rodgers and Hammerstein's Cinderella was in full swing. With a set budget of $12 million, the production set out to make magic happen.
Fairy godmother's sassy. She's honest, very direct, loving, very motherly. She's comforting. She's all the things that you'd want a godmother to be.
I've always hoped that someone would come and take me away from here.
Cinderella, if you want to get out of here, you're going to have to do it yourself.
In September of 1997, Disney Telefilms president Charles Hirschhorn said that Cinderella was the most expensive upcoming project. The film's budget was approximately four times the size of a typical television film, and even bigger than the budget of Disney's 2008 High School Musical 3, which had a theatrical release. But Disney granted the producers this amount because they felt confident that the film would eventually make its budget back once it was released on home video.
They are sparing no expense with the wardrobe or the elaborate dance numbers here. You could say that it is costing them a princely sum because the Hollywood rumor mill has it that Cinderella is one of the most expensive made-for-TV two-hour movies ever made.
Pretty big for television.
This
it's
is huge.
Pretty huge.
Yeah. Budget.
Big.
There's a lot of dough here.
Man, somebody's writing some great checks at Disney.
The first order of business was the musical score. Disney asked the Rodgers and Hammerstein organization to be as open about the changes to the musical score as they had been about the script and cast. Music producers Chris Montaigne and Arve Martin were interested in combining Broadway legit with Hollywood pop. The Rodgers and Hammerstein estate agreed, but made them aware not to get too carried away with changes.
It's original Rodgers and Hammerstein, yes. Yeah. Oh, you don't mess with R&H. There will be no messing with R&H.
The score of the film was updated accordingly, and new songs from the Rodgers and Hammerstein's catalog were added to fit the talent in the film. The sweetest sounds from 1962's Broadway musical, No Strings, was originally sung by Diane Carroll and was used as the opening duet between Cinderella and the Prince.
The sweetest sounds I'll ever hear are still inside my head.
The kindest words I'll ever know are waiting to be said.
The most entrancing sight of all is yet for me to see.
Falling in Love with Love from 1938's Broadway musical The Boys from Syracuse was adapted into a song for Cinderella's stepmother.
Falling in love with love is falling for make-believe.
Falling in love with love is playing a fool. Caring too much is such a juvenile fancy. Learning to trust is just for children in school.
The filmmakers wanted to give the song to Bernadette Peters and prove that the stepmother was not simply an evil character, but rather a product of bitter experience.
I fell in
Rodgers also wanted the character of Lionel to have his own musical number, so they decided to combine Your Majesty's with the town crier's The Prince is Giving a Ball from the original musical score and make it an elaborate song and dance sequence.
Now if it please Your Majesties, I have a list of wine, the best of all the vintages from every nation's vine.
Surely I'll need a side of ham and lots of beef fillets, some marmalade steaks, a rack of lamb, and veal you raise to braise.
Whitney Houston described herself as familiar with the flavor of Rodgers and Hammerstein's material and opted to perform their songs as originally intended as opposed to her signature pop, R&B, or gospel approach.
And for white mice are easily turned to horses. Such quality roll and fiddle-dee-dee, of course.
You've done gospel and you've done, right. done it all, but this is show tunes. Is right. there anything different for that?
Well, I'm a musical buff. I love musicals. From a child, I've loved them. So this music to me was like a dream come true. I could actually sing my fantasy of being Julie Andrews or
something. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Zayden and Maren wanted Whitney to end the film with a wedding song for Cinderella and the Prince, but they didn't quite know which one. Only a few songs were remaining in Rodgers and Hammerstein's catalog that were deemed suitable until they rediscovered There's Music in You from Rodger and Hammerstein's 1953 film Main Street to Broadway. They played Whitney the song and the rest is history, and it became her big number for the end of the film. The recording process challenging because the film's songs were different from any material she had recorded before.
10 minutes ago, I met you.
But this Cinderella is also about the music. It is, after all, a remake of the Rodgers and Hammerstein classic that first starred Julie Andrews 40 years ago. It's not Brandy's usual style, but that's what she likes about it.
Impossible. That would be like the is like R&B. You were not doing that in the movie. I did something completely different, just kept it straight.
Brandy was an R&B singer. Gospel was in her roots as well. So this kind of singing was new to her. But you know what? She embraced it like a champ.
It's kind of different singing for me.
Yeah?
Because I'm so used to the R&B pop thing, you know.
Did you grow up with Broadway music, listening to shows?
I listen to a lot of music, like classical and everything, so I'm kind of into it, but it's kind of hard to sing, so.
Yeah.
I hope I don't crack today.
Listen, I heard you in rehearsal. You were amazing.
Thank you.
For Cinderella and for Brandy, dreams do come true, but they don't come easy. You have to believe, but you also have to work.
Being Cinderella is actually a challenge for me because it's so different. It's like you have to practice more. You have to sing.
Lovely night.
Brandy, we feel that we have it, but let's do just one more.
Sure. Anything else? And I get a chance to find out what I have inside of me that I've never found out before.
Brandy? Brandy? Can you go back in and do one for the film, please?
5, 6, 7, and.
The comments in this room are that you're dancing while you're singing, so you could be breathy also.
Okay.
In the arms of my love, I'm flying over mountain and meadow and glen, and I like it so well that for all I can tell, I may never come down again. I may never come down to earth again.
Yes.
Paolo, you are amazing, let me tell you.
While in the studio, she would sometimes struggle to project, but her fairy godmother was always there for guidance.
What was it like working with Brandy?
She was the only person I thought about playing Cinderella. fairy godmother Cinderella relationship already existing, kind of, you know. Over the years, it's been like sometimes I'm her older sister, sometimes I'm like a mother, sometimes I'm a friend.
Aren't you going to invite me in?
Brandy and I have a very, sometimes it's big sister, little sister.
Right.
Sometimes it's mother to daughter, sometimes it's sister to sister.
Right.
You know, it varies on different levels. It's according to what we're talking about, what we're dealing with on that particular day.
Wait, Brandy, come on, we gotta sing.
She called me the night before and said, you gotta be ready, you gotta be ready.
Okay, possibly.
She was a very sweet and innocent child.
Haven't I just do that note and go all the way back from the mic and I'll come forward.
Who just really needs encouragement to get to the next step.
I just wanted to do it right.
At the end of recording for It's Possible, both Whitney and Brandy's voices were shot. So during post-production, the producers asked Whitney to come to the studio to sing the final note needed for the end of the song. And without any warm-up, Whitney sang the final note on the song, which is the high D that we hear in the film version. She later told director Robert Iskove,
I've always been able to do that. Ever since I was a little girl, I've just opened my mouth and sound comes out.
Can I please rehearsal?
When we were creating the world of Cinderella, you wanted to make it real in one sense, but you also wanted to have that sense of wonder that you had at a five-year-old when you first heard the story of Cinderella.
The production had 8 weeks of rehearsal to stage and choreograph the production. Dancer Travis Payne said,
Brandy was very concerned about coming into rehearsals prepared. She wanted to be good at this. She was concerned about the art.
I'm the greatest prima donna in my life.
I think it's every girl's dream to be Cinderella, and I feel so honored to be so young and to have this part.
In this multicultural production, Brandy co-stars not only with Whitney, but Jason Alexander, Whoopi Goldberg, and Paolo Montalban, who plays her Prince Charming.
In the arms of my love, I'm flying.
And she's not too upset to be working with Paolo. Brandy thinks he's a prince indeed.
Isn't Paolo gorgeous? I get chills every time I smoke. How can you create something like that? He's gorgeous.
I may never come down to earth again.
Through the process, Brandy learned how to waltz and dance in glass slippers, although not all of the shots of her feet in the film were hers.
Hi, Brandy. Is that a gift for me?
Yes, this is my glass slipper.
The glass slipper.
I didn't wear.
You did not wear this one.
I didn't wear that. It's too small.
I was going to say, is this your shoe size? Because I'm like Amazon woman compared to this.
No.
What size is this?
I think that's a 5.5.
What size shoe are you?
A 9.
Rock on, sister friend. Me too. Give me a high five on the 9.
Those were not my feet because I wear a size 9. And a 9 on television looks like maybe a 12. That's a secret.
Brandy had never waltzed in her life, and that gown sure didn't help.
When I tried to dance it yesterday, I almost fell.
In the arms of my love, I'm flying over mountain and meadow and land.
Dancing. The dancing. I got the ballroom dance, learning something new. That was fun, to learn how to really, like, hold my neck the right way and keep my shoulders down. And once you get it, you feel like you're flying when the music is going and you're in the moment.
I just thought they were just a beautiful couple. They were both so innocent and so loving and so sweet.
When Brandy, as Cinderella, appeared at the top of the staircase, she literally looked like an angel walking in. I look up and first I can't breathe because she takes my breath away, but then you look closely, I'm breathing as if I'd come home.
I remember being very nervous walking to the front of the stairs. It was just the first time I felt like I was Cinderella.
She was the belle of the ball. She walks in and the room stops. The most beautiful girl in the world has come in.
That when Brandy came out in her Cinderella dress, no acting required. And actually, I had to take maybe 10 extra breaths because she was so stunning. She was just so stunning at the top of the staircase. And they probably took the first take because, I mean, I just recently saw that portion of it. And it was like, this man is not breathing because he's seen the love of his life appear at the top of the staircase.
I really did feel like a princess. I knew that this was so great for the world to see, especially Black people, is that she had braids in her hair. She represented a culture that is beautiful, and I just so appreciated that because that was so much a part of what I wanted to bring to Cinderella.
Which was saying to young people that were watching, this could be you. There's a place for everybody, there's a chance for everybody. It's a story for every little boy and girl of every color.
10 minutes ago, I met you.
The actors also developed their character traits. Minerva itched.
And for heaven's sake, Minerva, stop scratching yourself! I can't help it, Mother. You know how I get itchy when I'm nervous.
No! Calliope Mother? Giggled.
I've been working on my naturally infectious laughter.
Excuse me?
Tonight, I'm going to laugh infectiously at all the prince's jokes.
I beg you, Calliope, whatever you do, try not to snort.
Yes, Mother.
And the queen squeaked.
Max, what's he saying?
He's saying he doesn't want to have another ball.
No, he's not.
Mother, I'll go to the ball. But if I don't find her tonight, you'll let me fall in love my own way, with no interference, no matter how long it takes.
I was trying to get Paolo to do something, and he was trying to explain why he wasn't going to do it, and so I did that thing that parents do when they really don't have any words that they want to share. It's just like, there was another pitch in there, but I don't have it right now.
Oh. You had more range, darling, more range.
Oh my gosh.
The creative casting was just the beginning. Every element of the film had to be fresh and exciting. The costumes had to be dazzling. And the sets, well, they had to be nothing less than breathtaking.
The sets are like a dream. I never thought that animation can really come to life. It was like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God.
That is the bomb! You guys! Look at my butt! It's beautiful!
This version of the classic tale was the first of the three versions to be shot on film. So the producers wanted to make sure everything was perfect down to the last detail. The producers wanted the film to be as colorful as it could be, highlighting elements of a beautiful storybook. Prince Christopher's Palace was built on the same location as the Yellow Brick Road from the film The Wizard of Oz in 1939. So the palace's courtyard bricks were painted yellow in homage to the classic film. During filming, many of the cast's children visited the set, including Whitney's daughter, Bobby Christina.
Oh, they just came like the other day. I'm a happier woman. I miss them very, very much. Isn't she something? She's growing up on me. It's for reasons like that that this is existing.
Mary Rodgers and James Hammerstein also visited the set.
While previewing footage for the film, Mary said the set was the most incredible set she had ever seen and loved the fact that millions of children were going to hear Brandy sing, "I can be whatever I want to be." What better message could we send than that?
Oh my God!
Brandy's excitement and awe was obvious as she took her first look at the elaborate and detailed sets built for the multi-million dollar production.
Oh my God!
And that was Brandy's basic response to everything.
I can't believe this. Oh my God, this is a house! Look at the piano! It works. Oh my God. I feel like Cinderella right now. Let's practice.
But even with those eye-popping costumes and flawless footwork, Iskov needed some Hollywood magic.
Quite possible. It's possible.
Computers filled in parts of Cinderella's coach, and after Whitney flew in front of one special effects wall and Brandy rode by another, they were spliced together. Fairy dust and fantasy background were added later.
It's a composite of about 25, 30 layers for that shot.
Things are happening every day.
Film's costumes were designed by Ellen Mirajnik, who aspired towards making them both funny and stylish in appearance.
And whether she's lowly Cinderella or the belle of the ball, Brandy is every inch a princess. Even when she's racing around the set in Cinderella's wedding gown.
Hold on, guys!
Famed costume designer Ellen Mirajnik needed more than fairy dust to create these clothes.
We have satin, and we have pearls and diamonds and crystals. I've got to have someone behind me all the time.
Just how Ellen made those glass slippers is her secret.
Cinderella's glass slippers were also made of shatterproof acrylic as opposed to glass, and only one pair was designed to fit Brandy's feet, and it was used at the end.
But she used every fabric imaginable for over 100 costumes.
This is raw silk, actually.
Whoopi Goldberg's gowns are made from antique Indian saris. Whitney's glowing dress is hand-sewn with metallic thread. And stepsister Vianne Cox got even more.
Your sister.
It's a fake butt!
In order to give Cinderella's gown a magical look, she combined blue and white detailing into the dress, in addition to incorporating a peplum, a design element that had not been used in previous versions of the gown.
There is an element of fantasy that you bring to the costume. What we did was actually continue the themes throughout in the design of the fabric, in the design of the appliques. Here it is on Bernadette's coat. It's on Brandy's spirals. When you sign on to do a princess show, there are rules. Many, many moons ago, they drew Cinderella in a blue dress. Those rules have to be adhered to. Cinderella will always have a blue dress.
We wanted the costumes to, like, just transport you immediately to something gorgeous and special and romantic.
The costume department originally created fake jewelry for the queen's character, which consisted of rhinestones for her to wear during the film's ballroom and wedding sequences. However, Whoopi Goldberg insisted that the film's queen should wear real jewelry instead and personally contacted jeweler Harry Winston to lend the production millions of dollars worth of jewels, which ultimately included a 70-carat diamond ring and a necklace worth $9 million and $2.5 million, respectively. Harry Winston also supplied the set with three armed guards to ensure that the jewelry remained protected at all times and was safely returned at the end of filming. It has been estimated that Whoopi Goldberg wore approximately $60 million worth of jewelry for the film.
Whoopi!
Well, look, I felt if I was going to be a queen, I should have real jewelry. I called over to them and said, would y'all do this for us? Now, I don't know if you know this, but I also did this with the Muppets. Mm-hmm. When Piggy and I did Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend, I called them and I said, listen, I'm doing the Muppets and we're singing Diamonds Are a Girl's Best Friend. And the guy said, and you want some diamonds, don't you? And they sent us $200 million worth of jewelry to choose from. God. Plus, the guys were standing right there. But they, you know, and so we knew it was real. Mm-hmm. The audience hopes that it's real. Mm-hmm. But it was just a little thing. And, you know, I've trained myself not to be sticky fingered.
During the month-long shoot, the production did face its challenges. One of the most difficult scenes to shoot in the film was the princess giving a ball scene.
The big number I had to prepare for was the Rob Marshall extravaganza in the marketplace. And I always have to thank Rob Marshall and every choreographer I've ever had, because people think I can dance. And the truth is, I'm a mover, but they surround me with some of the best dancers in the damn business. Just up my game and go, well, I guess he's blending in. So,
that charisma too, though.
Oh, bless your heart. That was just so much fun to do a number that size. You know, those are usually numbers that are done in animation style in a Disney film. And here we were on that back lot doing this for real, you know, with Rob pulling everything, every stop out to make it that much fun. It was great.
There were a lot of moving parts to it, and it was all shot outside on the back lot of Universal Studios on their European streets. Robert Isco recalls that the communication was difficult because once the playback was going for the music and the actors are singing, nobody can hear you shouting directions. Deborah Martin Chase also recalled,
we had promised Brandy that she could shoot The Princess Giving a Ball in the morning and she'd have the rest of the day off. She'd made plans to go to the mall with her friends. Between Moesha, her recording career in Cinderella, and her album promo, she was working nonstop. That day, we went over time, and we needed her to work in the afternoon. A lot of my job was working with the actors. Brandy was in her trailer, and she wouldn't come out. I went in there, and it broke my heart. She was curled up in a little ball in her bed, and she said, I just for once want to have a normal afternoon and do what other teenagers get to do. And I had to have that conversation with her. I told her, this is what you signed up for. There are hundreds of extras and crew out there waiting on you. And this is the job. But it broke my heart because she'd worked so hard and I empathized. To her credit, she got up, went out, and did it. And it doesn't show up on screen.
Towards the end of filming, the production didn't have enough money for extras for the last day when shooting the wedding. Craig Zaden asked the same Disney executive who wanted a white Cinderella for more money because they couldn't afford the extras for the last day. And he simply replied,
you don't need them.
Whoopi Goldberg was so upset at this notion that she sent an envelope full of cash from her per diem to the executive's house with a note that read,
here's my contribution for the extras for the last day.
The Disney executive still refused, and Zayden and Marin and Deborah Chase all had to pay out of pocket for the last day. This also meant that there was no way of shooting Whitney Houston at the wedding, so they had to use green screen and add her in for a wedding song in post-production. And finally, in July of 1997, and after 8 weeks of rehearsal, 4 years of development, and 28 days of shooting, the project was now complete.